Hello, welcome everyone. I'm Ravi Gupta. I am CEO and founder of Elets Technomedia Private Limited. And Elets is a 17-year-old organization which has been working in the field of spreading the ideas of innovation. We have been mainly working in the field of governance, smart cities, health, banking and finance, and the education sector. But besides this, we also work in around 30 more sectors, which are spread around housing to transport to agriculture to various other issues which are related to the day-to-day life of the citizen. And today we have a special guest with us on this webinar. He is Dr. J. Suresh Babu. He is an IAS officer and he is the chief secretary of government of Manipur. Welcome, sir. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Namaskar.
Namaskar, sir. And before we start the interaction, I will give a brief idea about our speaker. Dr. J. Suresh Babu is an IAS officer of Manipur cadre of 1986 batch. He is currently posted as the chief secretary in the government of Manipur. And prior to this, he was serving as additional chief secretary of the Manipur state, and he is also like has been also the member secretary of state commission for OBC and various other committees he has headed in the government, and he has a long career in the civil services, and he did his MS in general surgery from the PGI Chandigarh. So I welcome Dr. J. Suresh Babu here, and you have a background in the health sector. You have taken education in the health sector, and you are right now heading the state in terms of the governance of the administration. So, and today our topic of discussion is the COVID-19 situation. So, Dr. Suresh Babu, we would be interested in knowing about the COVID-19 situation in the Manipur state and how is the government handling the situation, sir?
Manipur is a very remote state. All these days we used to feel we are remote, but today we realize that remoteness is also a blessing in COVID. We were much safer. Yes. But you see, we have taken precautions right from the day one. When the country has started witnessing the cases, the first thing we did is that we are the first state in this country who did 100% screening of all the domestic passengers. We started way back in January, and we have screened more than 2 lakh people who came from the domestic sector. And this has been continued till the entire lockdown on the airlines has happened. And simultaneously, we also sealed up our international border much before the Home Ministry issued the order, because we don't want to take any risk. And we also sealed our state borders. So we protected our population, which were virgin population who were not exposed to any of the COVID. Now, we subsequently got 2 cases, and both the cases are also imported. One from UK returned, another also from the Nizamuddin Masjid episode. Fortunately, both of them are treated. Now, the entire scenario went on well. Now the COVID entered into phase 4, where we wanted to take back our people who are stranded. I got about 80,000 people who are stranded outside. So we want to take back. Now in the last 10 days, there is a spike of almost today, I got 53 cases, out of which 5 are cured. I still have another 47 cases, and every day number is adding. And these are basically the returnees who are coming. Now we have taken a very conscious decision in the state government that the people who are already staying here should not be exposed to this disease. So containment action has been taken seriously, that whoever is entering the state, whether by rail or by road or by air, has to compulsorily undergo quarantine and also testing. And we have put 100% testing mechanism here, and we are doing RT-PCR test, not a real regular antibody test. We are doing the real test of RT-PCR, and only when the person is found negative, he is sent for a home quarantine. If he's positive, he has to stay back in the hospital under isolation, under treatment, depending on the condition. But we are isolating the people who are coming from outside so that they doesn't mix up with the main population. So far we are protected and we'll continue to do this. This is our commitment to the people, and we don't want to risk the people by exposing them, and I don't want the society to get infected overall. So that's how we are managing so far.
Fantastic. So at least it is a good news to hear such low numbers in these times when each state is like the numbers are increasing daily, and we are all scared when we watch the TV that the numbers are growing. So the challenge right now, as you mentioned about the returning of the migrant population, which has been outside, which has been stranded, and they are all eager to return home, which is natural. Now the like as you are mentioning that 80,000 people have been are stranded, and like they would be all interested to return home and feel safe. How is the preparation if the numbers increase of the migrants and they have the positive cases? So what are the facilities, like how many beds of quarantine centers, how many beds of like hospital beds are ready at this moment in your state?
Yeah, I already told you that you see, we got about 80,000 people who are registered with us. Mm-hmm. We have opened a helpline website here where online registration is going on. So out of 80,000 people, nearly 40,000 people wanted to return back home. Not that everybody wants to return. Some of them are employees also who are stranded outside. They are looking forward for the industry to open or the employment opportunity to open. But I have many of the people who are like students whose schools and colleges were shut down. They want to come back. And also I got my state contributes hugely on two sectors. One is the hospitality sector and also the nursing sector. So the hospitality sector is, everybody knows that it is the worst hit in the current situation. The hotels are shut down, the spas are shut down, salons are shut down, restaurants are shut down. So nobody knows when it is going to open. And they get for a mere salary, which is sustainable for them. Now without salary, they will not be able to sustain in the cities where the house rent and other expenditure is so high. So the government has taken a conscious decision that we should put our stuff forward. Now we have, out of these 80,000 people, those who need some assistance, government has provided online transfer of the funds to about 35,000 people are given financial assistance by transferring money to their bank accounts. And those people who want to come back, out of the 40,000 people, Northeast, among Northeast states, Manipur is the first state which took a lead initiative that whatever it may come, we want to bring back our people. See, there are many states who think that, no, we don't want to expose our people. But we have taken a decision, yes, these are our boys and girls who are stranded there. If we don't help, who will help? So we have taken a decision, let us handle it the way it comes. And we have started, so far I have brought 20 trains. I got trains from Chennai, got from Bangalore, from Mumbai, from Baroda, from Delhi. Okay, I got from Goa also, from Gujarat. So wherever my people are there, they are maximum concentrated, especially in Delhi, Bangalore, Chennai, and Mumbai. So I have arranged and taken risk of bringing 20 trains, and some more trains are in the pipeline. They are coming. So far, about 16,000 people have already reached by train, and another 7,000-8,000 people have reached by road on their own. So I got almost 50% of the people who want to come back have returned back. Now, all these people are put in quarantine centers. I established around 17 institutional quarantine centers, which are directly run at the state level. But government of Manipur has taken conscious decision to rope in the public in managing the these quarantine centers. So we have established we got a home quarantine, we got an institutional quarantine, which is run by government. So we have taken a decision to develop a community quarantine center. So where the MLAs, the local clubs, the local women groups are associated in managing those quarantine centers. So far, I got about 770 community quarantine centers, which are operational. So whoever comes are taken there. So we are not keeping them all at one place. We are sending them, segregating them into those areas, district-wise and subdivision-wise, and they are put there. They are managed well. Government bears the expenditure. And at the same time, community is also cooperating and taking care of their requirements. And this is a mass movement that is going on, which community involvement to take care of the people who return so that they don't feel isolated. And everyone is undergoing testing, and whoever is getting test positive. So far, I said we got about 53 cases which are undergoing treatment. Unfortunately, almost 90% of them are asymptomatic, and they are quite doing well, and I'm very hopeful that all will be discharged in due course of time.
Very interesting, and so much heartening to see that your state has taken this initiative of taking care of your people. You are actually announcing special trains for them, and you are welcoming them, which is I think a very positive development and positive news, I will say. And good to see that they are not all of them are staying together. You are segregating so that like it's not contained, but it's like the patient, they are isolated, and they are going to their districts also. So I you are talking about a decentralized approach in this whole situation. So if you can talk about like what is the medical facilities available in Manipur in the worst case scenario, if the numbers of the COVID-19 patients increase, so how many beds are available, how many doctors are available, what is the situation?
Yeah, we got two medical colleges here in Manipur. Mm-hmm. One is the Regional Institute of Medical Sciences run by the central government. We got a state-owned medical college. Each one is a 500 bed capacity. So far we have earmarked about 100 beds in each place for treating the COVID related cases. And today we are opening another 300 bed isolation ward. Outside we are hiring the private establishments. So we have enough capacity. If time requires and if the intensity of the cases is so high, we would like to declare one of the institutions as the COVID, exclusive COVID hospital. But we never thought that the situation will arise. But now as the migrants are moving in, the possibility of cases going up is also high. Yesterday also I got the three passengers who came by air positive, one by AirAsia and two by Indigo. So the possibility of cases coming by air also cannot be ruled out. And especially, see, all our boys and girls are coming back from red zones.
Yes.
Red zones like Calcutta, Bombay, Bangalore, Chennai, take their name. They're all in the cities which are really having a huge number of cases. So we are preparing ourselves fully, and if required, the capacity will be increased further. And I got excellent trained doctors, and most of my experts are all trained in big institutes like RNA Institute, PH, Chandigarh, Jipmer. So these are all, see, those days there's nothing about medical facilities. All our boys and girls used to go and study outside in the best of the institutions. So they are well equipped. And I got sufficient number of nursing colleges also who can give the backup for this. So we are ready to face it.
Great. And if you look at the different states of the country, each state has adopted a different testing strategy. Some are testing high, some are testing low, and different testing techniques are also being followed by different states. So how are how is your state looking at the testing situation?
See, if you have a proper testing facility, which is cheap and also not time consuming, that is the best tool available. But right now what we see, the rapid testing kits which were introduced into the field did not yield a proper result what we expected. There are many false negatives, which is not a good sign. So the entire rapid testing system and mechanism has been done away with. Now today we depend on the best possible test that is available in India, that is the RT-PCR test, which is a direct throat swab analysis which is being done. So we have taken a decision that everybody who comes from outside has to compulsorily undergo the RT-PCR test, whether it is a person, a public or belong to an office administration or a government employee or an army or anybody who is returning back. So we are compulsorily making them undergo this test, and there's nothing better than this. I know it's taking time because we doesn't have that much capacity, though we had two laboratories. The two laboratories are capacity is so low in the beginning. So initially they were doing 50 tests and all. Now it has gone up to 200. Now we have scaled up the testing capacity to about 1,000 per day. So I have got some backlog of the people who are standing in the quarantine centers. Now we are going to increase it to 1,500 like that per day. Beyond that, it's practically not possible because there's a limited capacity of machinery available as well as the manpower available who deal with the testing part. So I have to do with available resources, and Maybe within 3-4 days, we'll be able to keep rotating the people. So those who are tested negative, they have to vacate and go from the quarantine centers, go for home quarantine. So I'll be able to take the new batch. So I'm having the stress because the stress in the sense, not personally, but in handling the situation, basically because, you know, the cyclone was there in Odisha and Bengal. So a lot of trains got diverted. And these all the trains which started, which we expected to reach our place in a staggered manner, didn't happen because now all of them are clubbing together. Because as the tracks open, they all started moving in. So there's a huge traffic jam going on. And especially, Manipur doesn't have a railway station earlier. We have a small railway station called Jiribam, which is half a kilometer from the border. So the moment the train crosses Assam border to Manipur, you are into the railway station. And this railway station is never used. And you see that it was inaugurated 30 years back when I was sub-divisional officer of Jiribam. That is, now as chief secretary, I'm using that. You see, this railway station is first time put into full utility. This station never seen trains coming, and every day I'm getting the 3 trains, 4 trains and landing there. So, you see, ideally, if I'm able to stagger the train intake in such a way that my testing capacity moves at the same pace as the people come in, then people will be comfortable. But because of these natural calamity that has happened and the delay, now we are... this problem will be there for 3-4 days, and we'll be able to manage that.
And in this period of lockdown, the whole country was locked, and almost except the essential services, most of the other offices, factories, industries, shops, everything was closed. That affected the livelihoods in a big way. So how is the situation? And of course, right now the partial exit of the lockdown has happened and the restriction has been eased out. So how are you seeing the situation in Manipur and how it has impacted the whole livelihood and the economy, if you can talk about that?
The economy is affected throughout the country.
Yes.
This is nothing for Manipur. Manipur is also badly affected in that sense. But right from the beginning, you see, the essential services are operating. Essential services are operating. And at the same time, you see, Manipur is a handloom-based rural sector economy. So we have opened all the retail shops which related to the selling of the yarn or marketing of the handloom products and all. So we are trying to see that the majority of the people who depend on the handloom sector in Manipur doesn't get really affected. And at the same time, we have put all these handloom zone for making masks and other, you know, PPE type of material. So indirectly, we are also using their services. The self-help groups are also engaged fully in making the protection equipment. So this is the one part of it. The other part is, as far as you look at the economy related to the shops and other malls and all. See, I really feel as they are affected, but we don't want to risk too much of public concern, because yes, we can hold for another week, 10 days and yet to open our market. But at the same time, if we get the disease into the society and if it spreads, then it's going to be a panic situation. No matter how our economy can cope up later, it doesn't make any much impact on the health of the society. So we are balancing between the two. And at the same time, we have opened the MSME sector, because Manipur doesn't have a big industry. It all has got small scale industries. So the MSME sector is open after the fourth phase. Now we're operating it those industries which are not exactly located in Imphal city, those who are located in the outskirts, all are operational right now. And also at the same time, the rural economy has been opened, the agricultural activities are open, all the agriculture related shops, the implement, the fertilizer, all those related activities are also outside the lockdown. And at the same time, we also opened the NAREGA, Rural Employment Guarantee Program. We have dispersed the money to the panchayats to allow, following the lockdown norms, whatever is the national norm that are laid down, and the social distancing and wearing of the masks and all. And the people are now back into the action in the rural area. Yes, definitely in the district headquarters and the state capital, there are a little more restrictions because the population is more, the economy is not based on agriculture. So I think maybe after a week, 10 days, we may continue just a little bit more, because see, we suddenly seen a spurt of cases in the last 10 days. So obviously there's a fear psychosis going on in the minds of the people. So definitely they will also like to continue with the lockdown a little more stronger than what they are. So our people are more conscious. See, today in Manipur, sorry, every area is shut down by themselves. So you cannot enter into a colony, you cannot enter into a street, because the clubs and the local women groups, they're not allowing anybody to enter, because it's a virtual lockdown in each area. If you go into the interiors, see, even into the hills where the tribal areas are there, every village is sealed off by their own people, and they don't want anybody to come. If you look at some of the videos that have come in rural interior areas, the villagers, the tribal villagers have put up huts for isolation in the outskirts and developed into a small isolation village type. So that is the level of consciousness that has grown. And in fact, it's a fact that, you see, today, when the lockdown once started, the way the COVID has been perceived, so people are made to understand how to maintain social distancing, how to form the lockdown norms, how serious the disease is, how to contain, how not to spread. So this has, fortunately, has imbibed into their mind so strongly that they are following so strictly. Now, unfortunately, we are not able to undo it when we want to liberalize it, because this has been strongly gone into their mind as we have to do like this. Now, I cannot go and tell them, but they don't do. Now, COVID, we have to live with COVID, yes, let us adjust. So, there are people are not in a mood to accept it. Okay. So, that's why, if the government of India or the Civil Aviation Ministry, whoever may say that, health ministry may say, okay, you go and stay in home quarantine, people are not allowing them to come for home quarantine unless tested negative. It's a good sign. Yes, it's a good sign, but the amount of consciousness that has grown, awareness that has grown, and the way the people have been accepting the reality, accepting the ground reality and implementing it, it is a major thing that has happened in Manipur. And at the same time, so many philanthropic organizations, the NGOs, civil society organizations, they are on, doing so much of social service. They are collecting the material. Villagers are donating vegetables, eating materials to other villages. So these civil society organizations are collecting and going and distributing at different places. So there's a community concern also at the same time. Government concern is there. And both are going together. That's why we are successfully able to manage till now all this.
Very interesting. And I think in many other parts of the country, the situation has been reversed. People are seen breaking the lockdown. They are seen roaming the streets, and police has to control them. And in your state, the majority of the situation is, in Manipur, the situation is different. Like the acceptance of the people is higher, right? That's true. Very interesting situation. And if you talk about the new normal, as you mentioned in your discussions just now, that people are saying that we have to live with COVID, and that's why the airlines have got started, and shops have been opened in several parts of the country, factories are being asked to open. So how do you see the changes in the lifestyle in Manipur happening? How will people live in this new normal of COVID-19?
You see, as I told you, people are not accepting to live with COVID in Manipur. They're still following the lockdown. They're strictly following not allowing even their own relatives to come back home. They said, go and sit in the quarantine center first and then get tested. So if I'm able to successfully implement the model which I am following right now, the society is segregated from the disease probable passengers and people are coming back. So only after filtering, testing, they are put back into the society. I don't know how long this system, this method may continue, but if it continues successfully for almost another 1.5 months, if you're able to manage it, then the disease, when it comes to a low level, it doesn't matter whether it is to live with or doesn't live with it, because people are not in a mood to accept that we have to live with. Means they're not in a mood to accept that society should get that disease. But at some point of time, definitely, I cannot say that it can be contained fully, but when it comes to happen, then see, we are following the national norms everywhere. People are implementing it. And definitely, The worst affected sector will be the education in the coming days. Offices, of course, with a little bit of social distancing and cutting down the manpower, we'll be able to rotate them and run it. But when it comes to the schools, education sector is the one, whether colleges or school or universities, they are the ones which are going to be most affected, because we don't know when and how long this lockdown in the education sector will continue. Even when you start it, the possibility of number of people, the students that can go into classrooms, if it is to be made in shifts, then also it gets affected. Then if that gets affected, how do you cover the syllabus? I think the time has come where a little bit of reorientation is to be done on the education sector, whether the current curriculum and the syllabus, what is being taught to the students, is that really required to be done? This is the time when we reorient ourselves, put our education system in such a way that you put a job-oriented, employment-oriented education, moral-oriented education, you make the self-reliant citizen out of education. So we are now, it's an open-ended scenario. Now I'm a college student studying a degree where I studied three subjects, for example, botany, zoology, chemistry. Ultimately, three of them may not give me a livelihood. I go and search my own way. But in order to make more livelihood-oriented education, do we focus on one subject where his livelihood can be made instead of putting so many things into his bag where he cannot really take in the current scenario? So maybe in the changing trends should be like that in the higher education sector, then the entire education sector should be reoriented to see it will become an avenue for the employment opportunity for him, avenue for him only for his livelihood, and you should tune him to the technology, tune him to the future requirement where he will fit into a specific sector, specifically for a job. So he's more skilled than a generalist. So it's time that the curriculum also need to be reoriented, the education structure need to be reoriented, where we use optimally the available time, the available tools, and also the online education system, what it can suit, and also the opening of the new economies that will happen in the near future. So our people should be tuned to that rather than going in a traditional way. But other sectors, economy, yes, it will take its own time. The worst affected is the, as I said, the hotel industry, the restaurants which run here. And you see, we have so many visitors earlier, so many tourists. The tourist growth has been almost 300% in Manipur in the last 3-4 years. So we are very happy. But now suddenly, it is a different scenario. But now, I'm really looking at the entire tourism sector. If the people are willing to come, it cannot be the hotel or the traditional way. You see, the major tourist centers, so people can go and spend their time. So the tourist destinations will get reoriented. The tourism approach will get reoriented. So we are looking at various aspects of how to restructure our economy.
Sure. And you talked about the economic effects. You also mentioned about the lot of people from your state are into the field of tourism and hospitality, and they have returned to the state. So what are the steps state government is going to look at reviving economy and creating jobs, which is a big issue, I think, in the whole country and also in the state. So if you have any ideas on that.
See, the good thing that has happened is that today, I know how many of my people are staying outside.
Yes.
Earlier, I don't know. Now, as per the registration that has gone, we allowed everybody to register, whoever is outside. Now I know clearly that 80,000 people are outside who are registered with me. Maybe another 20% have not registered. Say for 1 lakh, out of 1 lakh, at least 80,000 are there. Now the website, the way we have designed. Now I know where from this boy, where is he staying, where is he studying, what is he doing. Now based on his occupational profile that has come, now I am doing analysis of that. How many people are the ones in each sector? In hospitality sector, how many of my people are working in hotels, how many are working in restaurants, how many are working in saloons, how many are working in computer sector, how many are working in industry. Now, we have done the profiling in the process, okay. Now, I got a profiling of all these 80,000 people who are registered with me, barring the students who will go back to their studies once the schools and colleges open. those people who left their jobs and came back. Now we are trying to pull in sector-wise. Now what we are thinking is that we are developing a plan. Now it will take 2-3 months for them, for the other parts of the states to reopen the economy. Till that time, I have to manage these people. We want to put them for further skilling. Okay, 2-3 months more. I want to put them in the skill development programs where they will be able to develop the skills and also train a new set of people, because these people are already skilled. It's not that they are completely unskilled. They are already working. They have the expertise. So their expertise we want to further enhance, and also at the same time, we also use their services to develop the skill development of the rest of the people who are due for it. And then these people who are registered with me, who like to engage the other state governments, industry, for example, hotel association is there. I can write to hotel association. Well, I got about 10,000 people, 5,000 people with me. These are the people. This is the profile of these people. So government want to act as a mediator to put them back. You see, now we don't want to leave them to a middleman who want to take them and bargain them and do that. The government itself can be a middleman. Now, we are taking a orientation in that direction where we use this bank, the profiles of all these people who are registered in this bank, to be projected to different industry sector where, depending on them, industries can pick them up. Because they also need. See, what is happening today? All the migrant labor, lakhs and lakhs of people are leaving all the states. See, like my state, UP people are going back, from UP people are coming to me. So every, there is a reorientation of entire population, repositioning of the population going on, where the places where the labor is required, labor may not be there. Where they have returned back to the state, there is a surplus labor who cannot be utilized. The entire migration took place because job opportunities exist in that place. Now we have left that place and returned back. Now there is a shortage there and a surplus here. So time will come, definitely in a month's time, where the industry, once it opened, they need the manpower. And by that time, I should be in a position to reposition people who have returned back. So we have engaged, my labor department and industries department are fully working on that. And I should be in a position in another 2 weeks' time to do a proper analysis for all these people and take care of them.
And as you had mentioned about tourism, there are some experts who are saying that domestic tourism will boom after COVID. Like lakhs of Indians go to Europe, USA, Singapore, all these places every year for tourism. And in these situations, these Indian tourists will avoid going outside for tourism. And there are predictions that they will look at Indian cities, Indian states for tourism. So if post COVID, whenever it happens, like say after 6 months or 8 months, whenever it is, if the situation happens that domestic tourists are looking at Indian destinations, the you have mentioned that the tourism in your state has increased to around 300% last year. But there lies a big opportunity for your state, that your state can emerge as a local tourism destination for Indians. And most of the Indians haven't seen Northeast yet. So how is, and you also mentioned about connectivity issue, railway, air, those things are lacking in Northeast. So how do you handle this situation, like the demand and supply and the logistics situation?
You see, tourism is going to take time to recover. Okay. Now, we are in a state where you cannot put your foot out of your door and can't go to the shop in front of your house also. Now, from this stage, you are expecting people to travel long distances for tourism. So we are in two contrasting situations. Okay. To bridge the gap is going to take, may not be months, it will take years. Now, unless it is necessary, don't go out. That is the philosophy.
Yeah.
Tourism is basically a leisure time spending. It will take time. Definitely, people who are going for international destinations will go back searching for domestic destinations when the confidence level goes. It's not a question of confidence level of the individual who want to come, but also the existing emerging scenario in the state where you want to go. there the cases should be less. Actually, virtually cases should be nil for anybody to go. Even one case also people are scared to go. But in, this is the time when the tourism needs to be reoriented a little bit. And once marketing is done well, it will flourish in the long run. In the long run. See, whatever the projections are made is not for the current year. It is a projection for in lieu of international tourism, the domestic tourism will flourish. That is going to happen. But issue is like this. Connectivity, as you said, is a big issue in the Northeast. But fortunately for Manipur, after Guwahati, in the entire Northeast, Manipur is the well-connected city. I run around 16 flights come here a day and night, every day. From once in a, twice in a week type of model, today I got 16 flights coming. I got so many flights connecting from Delhi, Calcutta, Bangalore, Chennai, Mumbai. That's not a problem at all. Connectivity by air is not a problem. Once the sector opens, it will operate. But railway is still going to take time. That is a different story. But the domestic tourism infrastructure that has been existing earlier need to be recouped properly. And the packages should be in such a way that the entire Northeast has to come together. Anybody coming to Northeast for a tourism package should be able to cover at least 4 or 5 states together. See, Northeast India does not, a single state cannot give a satisfactory level of tourism to any particular individual who comes here. Because 2 days, 3 days, you finish whatever you have to see. It's not a, unless you are a nature lover where you want to go to interior and spend time. So in the long run, there is need for linking, whether it is link Assam and Manipur and Meghalaya, link Assam, Nagaland and Manipur. See, this government of India, the tourism ministry has to come with specific packages in such a way that the tour operators will link these destinations where there's a satisfactory level of spending a week time, whereby they feel, yes, I have seen entire Northeast satisfyingly. It's not that one state you come and then you still feel, yes, half of the Northeast I have not seen. That type of re-approaching, planning is required to reorient tourism in the Northeast.
Yes, excellent inputs. And there are some questions by the audience. So I will, like, if you can see your screen, bottom of the screen, there is a Q&A button, or like I can read it also. So there is a question that Manipur is known for many tribes. What initiatives are being taken to bridge the gap between hills and the valley people during the crisis for active community participation? Yeah.
You see, the last 3 years, there's a complete reorientation of the divide that has happened. You see, there's a divide between hill and valley, tribal, non-tribal. There used to be a divide among the tribes also. Kuki tribe, Naga tribe. Oh, you see there? See, I got about 37 tribes in Manipur who have got different cultural identity of their own. Now, we made tremendous efforts in the last 3 years to bridge the gap. The infrastructural development in the hill areas has been given priority. Okay. Number two, the government moves everywhere. I started a program called Go to Village. The government started a program called Go to Village, where in a 3 month span, the entire administration of all the departments in teams have visited every village, organized camps there. 100% village coverage has been done. Never in the history of independence, this has happened in Manipur. There are hundreds of villages where the administration has not visited in the past. We have connected, we've gone to the people where we have sat down with them one day, full day, the entire administration. And you should see the photographs which I keep getting, the difficult terrain in which the people used to travel. The officers used to walk 2-3 days to reach a village and yet reach and talk to those people. So there is a sense of belonging that has grown. And at the same time, the communal harmony has also grown. The state government started conducting its cabinet meetings in the district headquarters. We used to go to all the districts, and the cabinet meetings which used to be held in the state cabinet hall are now held in the district headquarters. Whether it is hill district or valley district, we are rotating. And at the same time, we have a chief minister conducts a special day called the Miyam Ginimit, that is the public day every month. So thousands of the people come from hills and valley and meet him. Now, the leadership, apart from the bureaucracy, the leadership has gone to the people. And definitely, I'm not saying that everything is normal. Everything is not, nothing can be normal in any place. Okay. It is how much you adjust, how much you try to bring it to a normalcy. And if somebody says everything is normal, it's also wrong statement. Okay. In any part of the country. So it is a near normal situation, anywhere we manage. And how do you manage? That is what the bureaucracy is meant for and the political setup is meant for, to manage it. So in Manipur, I am satisfied that in the last 3 years, the trust factor between the tribal, non-tribal, hill and valley people, and also the confidence levels of the people in the governance has definitely increased. It will take time to bring little much more reorientation among the minds, because there's a mindset which has been blocking people. There's a factor of mistrust that has been broken to a greater extent. Even yesterday only, Chief Minister had a meeting with all the tribal leaders where they were made the COVID warriors of the Patil tribe. And we are roping in everybody, all the civil society organizations, irrespective of tribal, non-tribal, are a part of this entire thing. That's what, see, the COVID has brought many positivities, you see. That's what we are feeling. Yes, you see, now we feel united on a fight. I think it's a matter of how do we pursue the situation. And the way I perceive may not be same as the person who asked this question perceives. But overall, the situation has definitely improved. The trust factor is very good right now.
Excellent. I think you have highlighted a very important point that what are the positives of COVID-19? It has united the community. The community is together. And that's a positive aspect of this whole situation. And there is a question, in fact, someone has asked that, what are the challenges faced by faculty, the schools, you talked about schools and colleges, the teachers. How are they able to teach in these situations? How are the students are able to study in these situations? Are these schools and colleges closed or something which happening online? So if you can talk about this.
You see, right now I said the schools, colleges are closed. As a lockdown policy at the national level, schools and colleges are not yet open. Now, we have utilized this time. The Department of School Education has developed online content. In the last 2 months, my department is fully engaged in it, and it was launched on about a week, 10 weekdays back. The entire software has been launched. Okay, that's one part. Developing software doesn't solve all problems. Okay, now, as I said, in the education sector, whether it's school or colleges, now all our schools and colleges are crowded. So maybe that need to be done in shifts. Once the colleges and schools open, the teachers and students may have to attend the schools in shifts. But that also doesn't give enough time for the students to prepare. So simultaneously, we have a hybrid model that has to emerge. That is classroom technology plus online technology. It has to merge together. So you cannot spend the full time like what you used to spend in the school, because it has to be on patches, in rotation. So then you got half of the time available for you to spend in the school. Maybe perhaps remaining time you have to go for an online. But online has got its own problems. Now, for online things, you need to have technology, internet connectivity everywhere, which may not be, we have to really see that every village has got a coverage of internet. And second thing is that the child has got an equipment to read it. Even if I put online class, the students should have a mobile phone or a laptop or iPad to read. So these are the areas of concern definitely, where I think we will sit and see what Government of India policy will be there and what the state government can supplement to that. But as far as the content and online content is there, that has been developed and put in place, and the schools will be reopened as and when the Government of India reopens it. But the government, the NCERT, whoever is going to look into the syllabus content of this, they need to relook whether this is the syllabus which can be handled or not. What is the extent of the volume of the content then can be shrunk to accommodate the number of teaching hours that will be feasible, and at the same time, how to coordinate and take the students forward, because in a classroom, the teachers and students are visible one-to-one. In an online, it's not so, but in online system, when you teach, all the students are of not same caliber. Some are intelligent who are ready to grasp, some are mediocre who may not be able to grasp. So you will have a lot of disparity that will emerge in the process. And many of them may not be tech savvy, who cannot handle. Now you start an online examination. That also is going to be a problem. I think everything is for a change. Everything is for today. We are in a situation where many issues doesn't have answers. Answers will emerge in due course of time, and every problem will have a solution definitely. And I'm quite sure that education sector is one which we cannot neglect, and nobody can afford to neglect. And finally, I tell you, in this emerging education scenario that is going to come, the parents are going to play a major role, more than the teacher. Because earlier the student goes to school and college, he spends whole day there, comes back, you are okay. But now your child half the time is in front of you. Now, what is he going to do? Nobody knows except you at home. Even if I put an online class, you may study for 1 hour, 2 hours, you will play a computer game. How are you going to regulate it at home? So there are many issues that the parents has to take responsibility in the due course of time. So the I do hope that situation will emerge where a hybrid model will come for education sector.
So you have highlighted the hybrid model, and there is a question around that that how is the MSME sector affected in this situation, and how is government planning to help them in this situation where the economy has gone down?
You see, as I said, Manipur is basically MSME oriented state. Mm-hmm. You cannot have a big industry here because it doesn't have raw material, and it doesn't make any sense for raw material to be brought back to Manipur and again take back this finished product again to the same place to sell it. Mm-hmm. It's not viable. So MSME is a good one. And in MSME also, you see, majority, got large number of factories who are working on the food processing sector. During the lockdown period also, we have exempted the food processing units from the lockdown. So they were allowed to operate. And there are other MSME sector industries that are there. But government of Manipur is committed, okay, under the new scheme that has been announced by the Prime Minister for revamping the economy. We have given financial disbursement to different units recently. And at the same time, Manipur government itself has got a startup program. Okay. And recently, we have started a program called Stand Up Program for the industry sector. So we are going to definitely take note of all these things, and government of Manipur will do the financial support as much as possible under the startup program and Stand Up program.
And there is another question that how well the state of Manipur is prepared to provide citizen services digitally. I think he's talking about e-governance.
Yes, you see, we already have got a digital platform for all these things. We got a e-district project which has been implemented for a long time. Now, all the citizen services have to flow through this. Okay. Now, the critical bottlenecks in implementing the e-district project, especially for the e-services to citizens, is the back-end service support that has to be created. In some departments, yes, it has come. For example, you want a birth certificate, it is linked with the municipal administration main database. So basically, the common service centers which operate from the front end need to have the back-end database from which they can retrieve and give you documentation. Okay, so some departments has done it. We are going to focus more and try to improve that. And further, the IT department is working on that model. And we have started one citizen facilitation center, which even gives the visa and other facility support. So that also will be part of the common service center. See, common service centers, if you want to really make it functional, it's the right person that has been asked. We need to upgrade the backend, that will sure. I think in another 3-4 months time, that project will be completed.
I think the another additional question here is that a lot of citizens keep on visiting the government offices for various approvals, permissions, certificates. So if these services are online, then the citizens would not visit the government offices. And in the COVID-19 situation, the safety of both the government official is also important and the safety of the citizen is important. So if we decrease the contact, the physical contact, so in this situation, are you seeing that there will be more focus on the online citizen services because of the COVID-19 situation?
No, it's a wonderful suggestion. That's what I'm saying. That has to develop. That has to develop. And you see, the key focus areas where they really require relate to the municipal administration services, the education department related, revenue department. These are the three key areas where a lot of people have most of the documentation generation. So we will try to see that this gets into operational mode fully. It's already operational, but we'll see that it becomes fully operational. But at the same time, what he said, it's not only for COVID. If you reduce the contact, the corruption levels also will come down.
Yes. And last question, which is there, is about logistics sector. Because of the lockdown situation, the logistics sector got affected badly, and the transportation of goods and so between states got impacted, and the supply chain management, because factories are closed, the drivers of the trucks went on holiday, always scared, and it affected the overall supply chain management across the country. So how was that effect felt in your state, and how are you looking at the reviving the logistic and supply chain management sector?
You see, Manipur is not a producer state. It is a consumer state in a larger way, if I put broadly. Now, surprisingly, the number of trucks that have moved to Manipur with the goods, both essential and non-essential, during the lockdown period, is sometimes bigger than the normal time. You see, the supply chain we have maintained. Even if I shut down my state, another 15 days also supply is there in terms of material. Okay. Fortunately, the measures we have taken are yielding results. We have been coordinating constantly with the state of Assam, Nagaland and Meghalaya, where from our trucks move. And I'm also talking to the West Bengal government in facilitating the movement of the trucks. Okay. So all my government has been, my officers, set of officers are fully focused on this. And at the same time, the drivers and the handymen who come with the trucks are also taken care by us. So we have provided parking slots for them so that these drivers and handymen doesn't go and mix with the general population. We have provided a separate quarantine center for them in the bus terminal and other places where they are stationed. And in addition, I have given an incentive to them. Every truck driver that comes here to Manipur, driver will be paid 1,000 rupees and handyman will be paid 500 rupees for each trip that they come. Okay. I've been paying the last 1.5 months as an incentive, because that man, poor man is, you see, all of us are staying at home, but the driver and the handyman is the poor fellow who is driving, passing through all the states where there is infection, and en route, he has suffered enough because dabas are closed, food joints are closed, nowhere to eat except he cooks and eats himself. But in spite of that, he's doing duty. Many of them want to run away. It's not that mandatory that he has to do. Unlike me and you, or some other people or government employees, we work under obligation, willingly, unwillingly also. But these people are voluntary. And then they are willing to come. So we have taken precaution. I am giving them ration. I give them ration at the entry point of the state. I give them ration when they reach Manipur, where the parking place. I give them 1,500 rupees to the driver and handyman. I give them free food. I create a space for them to sleep. So the comfort zone that I've created for the trucks and all these people is much, much better. So they're happy to come. So the movement of essential, non-essential goods that are required, the chain is maintained. Only thing is, the consumption also has to be proportionately there in the society. Because of lockdown, the consumption has come down. So even if the material that has been brought by the business people, their stores are filling up, but the consumption is not going. So for him also, the business will only happen when he rotates his money and also the goods. So once we, in the fourth stage of lockdown, the way we opened the sector, a little bit of movement has already started happening. And in the due course of time, when we open the market fully, the logistical chain will take its own shape automatically. Now I have opened the construction industry. We have allowed the cement, steel, all these shops to be opened because I know that this is the season for me. Maybe after 1.5 months, I'll have rains here in Manipur. The working season will come down. So we don't want to waste the working season. So we allowed all the construction activities. So the construction material sale also has been permitted. So the chain will start. I understand what he is trying to say, but see, this is an automatic movement that has to happen. Me or you doing it will not happen automatically. When the lockdown is open, the process will start, the consumption starts, the material rotation starts. It will happen in due course of time.
So, Dr. Suresh Babu, thanks for giving us an deep insights on the situation in Mizoram. I think very interesting way of handling the problems are being seen in the your state. A lot of community participation, a lot of citizen participation, citizen ownership of the lockdown situation. It's a very heartening, heartening to see that. And we at ELETS are conducting these webinars with different stakeholders, different departments across the states and the central government to look at how are the various states and various departments facing this unique challenge and how are they helping the citizens in this situation. So, Dr. Suresh Babu, do you have any suggestions for our team at ELETS who are working in these situations to connect and create awareness about the learnings from each states, ideas from each states? So your inputs and suggestions for us at ELETS and our team.
You see, the so many viewers must be watching this. My sincere appeal to you is that, you see, let's not get scared. And at the same time, let's not take it easily. We have come to a situation where we are worried about even accepting our own relatives to our house. That is the current scenario, the psychological barrier that has come in. Now, in the given situation, you should understand, the people who are fighting for us on the streets, the health department, the police people, police, day and night, with a simple mask, they are working hard. The media, they are also running around. And the transport sector. See, there are so many people who are risking their life and then working for us. So let us respect them. And many instances are happening here and there. That should not be the one. But at the same time, we should learn to respect others. Our way of living is changing slowly. And in the coming days, you see a different behavioral approach that needs to be adapted by every one of us. And we have to accept it. And at the same time, my sincere appeal to all the people is that lockdown is for all of you. And at the same time, there are many people who are waiting when the lockdown will open. You see, people are looking forward for the lockdown to be open. You see, that's not the way one should look at. You see, even if the lockdown is open, I think a self-imposed lockdown is required. Unless our psychology and mind thinking changes that, yes, unless I work outside, I need not go and disturb others. Unless I have a real serious issue concerned where I should go and meet somebody, there's no need to meet somebody. Then you have to analyze and see. So those days have gone where you spend your spare time the way you like. Now, even if the lockdown is open, as I'm saying, self-imposed lockdown to the restrictive level is essential to see that the society is healthy. And I think once we learn to behave ourselves properly, I think no need for government to impose anything. That's what my take on this.
Very important message that we have to impose lockdown on ourselves and government does not have to impose. I think that self-awareness has to happen each of us. And I must thank Dr. Suresh Babu, Chief Secretary, Government of Manipur, for this amazing discussion. I so much learning that how much, like, how a state is dealing with this situation in such a nice way. The situation has been in control till date, and we are all hoping that it remains the same in your state and all over the country. And with this, I also would like to thank all the audience for joining us here. And if you have liked the way this state is doing this initiative in the COVID-19 and helping their citizens, please like and share this video so that these ideas reach out to large number of people, and others also think about this idea of self-lockdown instead of the government asking us to do it. So with this, I would end this, and thank you, Dr. Suresh Babu, and thank you all the audience. Namaskar to each other. Thank you so much. Namaskar. Thank you.